Today's shiur should be a zechut for refuah shleima for Avram Simcha Halevi ben Edel Rosenthal. We're in Shmuel Aleph Perek Tez Zayin. This is the last shiur before the summer, and then Yirtzeh Hashem will resume in Elul. I was thinking the last week, some of the feedback a number of people mentioned to me, that they found it sort of depressing that a person could be as good and as perfect as Shmuel, as Eli's sons, and as Shmuel's sons, and as Shaul, and it seems that everyone seems to fall short, and they're rebuked in the harshest terms, and they get a punishment. It just seems, you know, if they fail, you know, where does that leave us? I was thinking perhaps an analogy would be, if somebody wasn't yet, you know, frum, wasn't used to the religious lifestyle, and he walked into a shul, Shabbos Shuvah, and he hears the Rav darshaning and telling the people, what, tefillah? Is that the way you daven? People come late to davening, and people talk, and they have their eye on the clock, and they're rushing out, and where's their kavana? And the person walks in, and he thinks to himself, I'm thinking of being frum, but look at that. These people spend 2 hours a day davening with a commitment every single day, shachris, mincha, mariv, and they come to shul, and they're getting told that their davening's not good enough. Like, how can I even attempt it? The truth is, they're both right. The Rav is right for giving them shmooze to the people who are on that level. The Michtav Meleyo talks about a nekudas habechira, meaning everybody has a point at which he has a choice of bechira. He has a real choice to make in life. The idea in chinuch is a person's raised by his parents that certain things become easier. You don't wake up in the morning, it's not a nisoyon, should I daven shachris, should I not daven shachris. You've been davening shachris your whole life, so it's now easier. You don't have the nisoyon whether to daven shachris. Your test is to daven with kavana, and that's a very difficult thing. And the Rav is right for giving a shmooze, you got to do whatever you can that your davening can be with the best kavana. And the people listening to the shmooze realize, they know that they spend 2 hours a day davening, and they always come to shul, and they realize that whatever the Rav says, not that it's taken with a grain of salt. In other words, the Rav means, and the Rav is 100% correct, but they realize the Rav is speaking to them that on their level, they could do, they should be doing, and they could be doing even better. But the person who's not yet frum, and he walks in and he hears such a shmooze, the truth is, the shmooze is not addressed to him. Or somebody who hasn't been davening at all, and you're telling him, even if you spend 2 hours a day davening, it's not enough, that the shmooze is not really for him. So why are we learning this? And the answer is, first of all, you have to realize who the Gedolim and who the Tzaddikim and Klal Yisrael were. Or it's, it's a lesson based on their life, what we should aspire, our goal should eventually be to reach. But it's not like we're going to be judged on their level. It's understood that they're on a higher level. Just like a person who's not yet frum, he should be told, of course, he spends he has to spend time davening shachris mincha maariv, but there's a goal. It's not enough to just be sitting in shul. You have to do something. The person should know there's a goal. The person should even feel mosa yagia maisai lemasai avoisai. A person should feel, when am I going to try to reach such a level? But it should be in an inspiring manner. In other words, we see how great a person could become. And we'll see in the end, Shaul, who we're talking about now, seemed to be such a failure as a king. Chazal says in Gan Eden, together with Shmuel. Shaul was one of the greatest. As a king, he was rebuked harshly, and it was a failure. But in terms of him personally, and what we'll see, we're not finished with Shaul yet, even though we're now going to get into David shortly. But it's meant to realize how great they were and to take our lessons from it, but not to feel that, of course, we're being judged for not being on that level. Everyone has their... I say Rav Dessler speaks about the nekudas habechira, the point at which you're judged. Okay, we're on Perek Tazayin. Vayomer Hashem al Shmuel, Hashem said to Shmuel, Ad Mosai, till when? Atam Yisabel el Shaul, are you going to be mourning over Shaul? Now, he certainly wasn't mourning for years, because Shaul was only the king for 2 years. And everything had transpired in the past, and we're not finished with Shaul. But whether this was days or weeks or maybe months, I don't know, it wasn't such a long time. But Hashem said, Ad Mosai, till when? It's whatever mourning you feel over Shoal is misplaced. Why? There are two reasons why a person would feel a sense of avelus, of mourning. One is, a person feels that whatever was lost was something that was so precious and dear to them. And that item is now lost, or that person passed away, or the loss causes a feeling of avelus. The second thing is, even if sometimes the loss is not intrinsically that item or that person wasn't so special or wasn't so close, but whatever role he had is irreplaceable. There's nobody else who's as good or who can play that role. Not that he was so special or that item was so important to you, but if it's lost and you can't replace it, you feel bad. Here Hashem says to Shmuel, till when are you mourning over Shoal? First of all, Vanima Astiv, I despised him, Mimaloch al Yisrael. In other words, Shoal is not supposed to be king, and I don't want him as king, and he's nothing. You shouldn't feel bad the fact that he lost it. He's not fit for the role. You might feel, well, true, Shoal wasn't good as king, but who else is there? Shoal was chosen, he's the best. Mali Karnacha Shemen, fill up your horn with oil, with a special Shemen HaMishcha, V'leich, and go Eshlochacha, I'm going to send you all Yishai Beis Alachmi to Yishai, who lived in Beis Lechem, Ki Ro'isi Bevonov Li Melech, because I've seen in his sons somebody who will be a king for me. In other words, don't feel bad that Shoal is not going to be the king. Who's going to lead the people? There's nobody like Shoal. No. I see a replacement, and he's good, and he's better, and our Shoal is no good, and David is the one that I see, Ki Ro'isi Bevonov Li Melech. I see him as a king for me. Shoal was somebody that the people wanted. The people wanted a king, they were given Shoal. And we'll see, he was chosen, he had the physical stature, he had the looks of a king and the demeanor. He was somebody that if the people wanted a king, they were given somebody who they would realize immediately is the king. Now Hashem says, I have somebody else for king. He's somebody that we're going to see, even his own family, even his own father, nobody thought he would be king. But it's Ki Ro'isi Bevonov Li Melech. I've seen him as a king for me. Now is the time that Klal Yisrael is going to get the king that Hashem wants. Now, we don't see much about the Yichus of David. In fact, we don't see it. That's basically all it says. In fact, the Gemara mentions in Baba Basra that if somebody's asked, you don't even know the name of David HaMelech's mother. How could it be? What's the name of his mother? Doesn't say it at all. And the Gemara mentions her name was Nitzeves Basadil. The Gemara mentions the name. So if anybody asks you, you should be able to come up with what the name is. I even saw that Me'am Loes brings down that a source that if somebody says that name 17 times and then he davens, the davening will be makuvel, will be accepted. I guess the fact that she obviously must have been a tremendous tzaddikus to have zoicha to a son like David. This Nitzeves Bas Adil, it's a segula to say her name. Anyways, the Mishpach of Yishai, we know, came from Boaz. Boaz had a son, Oved. Oved means he served, because he served Hashem with his whole heart. He had a son, Yishai, that the Gemara says was perfect, had no Averis. And his son, we'll see, was the whole family was Chashev. And his son is going to be the one that's David, even though the psukim don't speak that much about the Yichus. I'm not sure. We will see a little later about Yishai, but it's not stressed his family. If anything, Chazal mentioned the other problem, that the fact that David came from Rus HaMoaviyah, this was a debate that seemed to go on for years and through the centuries, that the halacha is a Moavi, a man from Moav, cannot marry into Klal Yisrael. Because it was such a shortcoming, Al-Davar Asher Lokid Moeschem B'lechem Uvamayim, because they didn't greet Klal Yisrael with the bread and water when they came out of Mitzrayim. Amun and Moav, and then the fact that he hired Bilam to curse. So Amun and Moav cannot come in to Klal Yisrael. But that's only the men. The women could. That was why the originally Boaz ended up marrying Ruth, because the Goel did not want to marry her. He said, I can't destroy Pen Ashkisas Nachalosi. I'll destroy my whole family by marrying somebody like Ruth. She's from Moab. And he was wrong, and Boaz married her. But that underlying debate and concern persisted through the generations. And we're going to see David HaMelech, as great as he is always shepherded and persecuted that and questioned. Maybe he is so, it's such a flaw in his yichus, maybe he's not even allowed to marry a Jewish woman. Oh, he's a Moabi, he's like a Moabi, he came from Rusa Moabia. So at one point we're going to see he's from the greatest tzaddikim. On the other hand, there's always that lingering question and doubt, and the greatest Chachamim opposed David and bothered him and tormented him about the fact that he came from Moab. But Hashem says he's the one that I've seen for a king. Malei karnecha, fill your horn with oil. Way back in the beginning of Shmuel, when Chana davened, she sang a song and she said, Roma karni b'Hashem. And Chazal learned that my horn is elevated, my strength is elevated through Hashem. That with Nevuah, Chana foresaw that the one she anointed using a horn of oil would be the one whose malchus would last. Shaul was anointed with an earthenware jug that breaks and it doesn't have a permanence. It breaks, it shatters, and it can't be repaired. But the Keren, Male Karnacha, fill up your horn with oil. This is going to be the king that is going to remain for Klal Yisrael. It's going to be the beginning of Malchus Beis David. Vayomer Shmuel. So Shmuel said, Eich Eilech, how can I go? Vishoma Shol Vaharagani. Shol is going to hear that I'm going to anoint somebody else's king. Shol will kill me. Now that's a difficult question to understand. Moshe Rabbeinu, when Hashem told Moshe, go to Paro, Moshe Rabbeinu didn't say, maybe Paro will kill him. And I don't know, what kind of a concern is that? Hashem says, go and anoint David as king, and Shol says, how can I go? Shaul hearing to kill me? So there's a number of different approaches. One approach the Mephoshim mentioned is there are times when a person is given a mission by Hashem and for whatever reason he doesn't want to go. And our Shmuel was still hoping, originally Shaul was chosen by Hashem, maybe Hashem will decide to give Shaul another chance, maybe Tshuva can help. He didn't want to choose another king. But he didn't say directly to Hashem, I don't want to go. He came up with a lame excuse. And Hashem saw the excuse and Hashem answered him, Yomar Hashem, if that's your excuse, how, what are you going to do? I'll tell you what to do. Eglas boker tikach biyadecha. Take an egel, a calf, take a young animal. But Martin say, Lizboch Hashem Basi. People say, how come you're traveling out to Beis Lechem? You say, I'm going to bring a sacrifice. He would travel from place to place, he'd bring korbanos, he'd gather the people. That's what I'm doing. I'm going lizboach Hashem to bring a korban. Tell them that. But it wasn't a real concern that Shmuel was really afraid that Shaul, who was so, he was afraid of him and he loved him, and Shaul had such a sheichas with Shmuel, he wasn't afraid that Shaul would really kill him. That was an excuse. He didn't want to go. So Hashem said to him, too bad, if that's your excuse, take an animal, but you have to go. He compares it to like Moshe Rabbeinu said to Hashem, how can I go? He speaks with a stutter, he doesn't speak fluently. And how v'echish my life, Paro? How's Paro going to listen to me? I can't speak well. If Hashem tells him to go to Paro, so you go. What do you mean? You're worried Hashem knows exactly how he speaks, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu told him to go. The excuse is not I think the Barbanel brings it down, it's not a serious questioning, how could I go? It's a way of saying, I don't want to go, so he came up with an excuse, I don't want to go to Paro, I can't speak well. And Hashem said, what we learned about in Chumash. That's one approach. Another limud is the Gemara learns out from here, an idea of Ein Soim Chumal Anes. That a person is, you know, you don't rely on miracles. You're right, if Hashem tells him to go, he could go, and even though the natural thing is Shaul will pursue him and probably, possibly try to kill him, but you don't rely on miracles. And therefore Shmuel was questioning, how should I go? Should it be done in a manner that Shaul won't hear about it? Should it be done in public? Is there a manner in which I should go that, or maybe I shouldn't go at all? After all, he's going to go now and make David the king. David is not going to serve as the king till later. As long as Shaul was alive, Shaul was accepted as the king. So what's the point in anointing David now? In other words, you're telling me I should go and make David the king. How should I go? Shaul will hear and kill me. I don't see the necessity of going right now to make David the king. So if I don't have to go right now and make David the king, why should I do something that requires a special nace from Hashem? Or maybe I shouldn't go now. I'll go after. Shaul is nifter. And Hashem answered him, Eglas boker tichav yadecha, you could take an animal and bring it as a carbon. And the Gemara learns out from here also that umutu l'shanos mipnei ha-shalom, that in order to keep the peace, a person is allowed to say a sheker, to say a lie in certain cases to protect, to keep the shalom. In other words, instead of going and sparking a whole conflict in Klal Yisrael to come and say that you're anointing another king and then a civil war can break out and people are going to support David and Shaul's going to hear, keep the shalom, don't let anybody know, do your job and say, Eglas boker tikach b'yadecha, take this animal and bring it as a korban. See, it could be that was what the question and the answer revolved around. If he was just going to bring a korban, he could have traveled there with a bag of money and bought an animal in that place. By bringing the animal with him could be is to like publicize that. The whole purpose of my mission, we'll see, is to bring a korban, or we'll see possibly a different reason why he would take an eglas bokar. And a third approach, it's brought down in the Malbim, that is that there are two ways that a person is sent on a mission. When Moshe was sent to Paro, the point was to tell Paro he's not in control. Hashem runs the world. And this is the word of Hashem, and Hashem is protecting the Jewish people, and he is going to be forced to let Klal Yisrael go free. If the point is to show that Hashem is supervising, and Hashem is controlling, and Hashem is omnipotent, if that's the point, if Moshe would be killed, that would be a failure in the mission. Imagine if Hashem sends Moshe to Paro, to tell Paro that I'm letting the Jewish people go out, and then Paro killed Moshe. The whole thing would be a failure. The whole idea is to show that Hashem is protecting his people. Over here, if he goes and anoints David, the mission is to anoint David. So once David is anointed, if afterwards Shaul has Shmuel killed, that doesn't mean that the mission was a failure. That's where Hashem worked it out. Shaul was anointed and then Shmuel was killed. It's not related to the mission. The mission is not to show that Hashem is protecting Shmuel. The point is to make David the king, and he made David the king. In that case, if Shmuel would be protected, that would be called a nes. And if somebody has a miracle done for him, it detracts from his zechusim, from his merits, the fact that he needed a special protection. It could be the question was, Eich Eilech, how do you want me to go? Do you want me to go and make a public spectacle and to show that Hashem doesn't want Shaul and Hashem wants David? And if it's something done in public, that I'm speaking on behalf from Hashem that David should be the king and everyone's aware of it, in that case, I'm sure I'd be protected because that's all part of the mission to show Hashem wants David to be anointed. But if I go secretly and nobody knows about it, so if I secretly anoint David and just Shaul hears and then he kills me, so it doesn't like make a chil Hashem, it doesn't destroy the mission, or he anointed David and he was killed. In that case, if I go like that, I don't want to rely on a miracle like that, because that would take away from my zechusim. So, how do you want me to go? Do you want me to go secretly, or should it be done before Hesia in public? V'shama Shaul v'haragoni, Shaul might hear, he'll hear and he'll kill me. V'yomer Hashem, so Hashem said, Eglas boker tikach b'yadecha. Take an eglas boker, this young calf, v'omar ton, you'll say, lizboyach l'Hashem bosi, I'm coming to bring a korban to Hashem. An eglas bokar is something used for egla rufa. Remember, if there's somebody who's found dead, killed, and he's between two cities, and you don't know what happened, they bring a calf that never had offspring, and they have a whole procedure to bring a kapara. It could be, if it was just to bring a carbon, Shmuel would have traveled with his bag of money and gone to whichever place, Beis Lechem, bought an animal and brought a carbon. The very fact that he set out from home with an eglas bokar is because he specifically needed to have a calf, and it had to be an animal that hadn't been worked. He needed a special animal. He needed a special animal. By taking the eglas bokar and going to Beis Lechem, anybody who saw him would assume it could be there was an incident of an egla rufa. Could be there was and therefore, that's why the Ralbag brings us down. Maybe somebody was found dead in the area of Beis Lechem, and Shmuel is taking this eglas bokar to initiate the procedure for a kapara. Now, of course, when it gets to Beis Lechem, people know, read the Beis Lechem newspaper, and they know that nobody was found dead in the area. So when he gets to Beis Lechem, people are going to say, what are you doing with eglas bokar? He'll say, he brought it for a carbon. But if he does it like this, at the beginning he doesn't have to say anything. Just the very fact they see Shmuel traveling with an eglas bokar, he didn't usually take an animal and go traveling with this animal for miles. When they see him take it, they'll figure it's an eglas rufa. When he gets there, he'll say it was a carbon. And this way nobody will have any suspicions why he's going there and what he's doing there. It would also be a subtle reminder to Shoal that Shoal didn't want to wipe out Agog. And one of the reasons Chazal say is in his mind he was bothered. If a single person and we don't know who killed him, requires such a procedure, the Sanhedrin came and they had it's a terrible thing. If one person is killed and we don't know why, one person, one life is so valuable, how can I go ahead and wipe out a Malik? That was one of the things that bothered Shoal. Here, Shmuel took an eglas bokar. He's going to take this eglas bokar. It's a reminder. People see it, think, oh, egla rufa, somebody has been killed. Shoal, after that reminder, wouldn't kill Shmuel. Even if he would have that anger against Shoal, against Shmuel, that he's anointing somebody else as king, but he's like bringing along a reminder. Remember that eglas bokar? Remember that egla rufa? What one human life is worth. It's a reminder that would protect Shmuel from Shoal's wrath. So you'll come and you'll say, Lizboyach Hashem Bosi, I'm coming to bring a carbon to Hashem. And by the way, the Mefarshim mentioned there are other cases where you find, the Gemara discusses, Yaakov Avinu was promised, go back to Eretz Yisrael and I'll be with you. And yet when Yaakov met Esav, it says, Vayira Yaakov Ma'oid Vayetzer Lo. Yaakov was very worried and very concerned. What's going to happen when he meets Esav? Or even fine by David. David was anointed and told he was going to be king. And we're going to see he's running all over that Shaul shouldn't catch him. And as you see that, even though a person is promised, but the derech is to avoid relying on miracles and to try to avoid that situation where a person puts his life in danger. Maybe afterwards a person will do an aveir and he won't merit that protection. So even though Hashem told Shmuel, go and anoint the son of Yishai, Shmuel was concerned. You'll come to Beis Lechem, v'karosel Yishai v'azovach, you'll call to Yishai to participate in the carbon, v'anochi odia chayis asher tase, and I will tell you what you should do. And you'll anoint for me Esasher Omar Eilecha, the person that I tell you. What happens if somebody says to Shmuel, why are you going to Beis Lechem? So he'll say, I came to bring a carbon. Is there any other reason you're going? Now Shmuel would have to lie. Which could be he certainly could to save his life. But if somebody says to him, is there any other reason you're coming? He would have to say an untruth. He can't say he's coming to anoint another king. Hashem did him that favor. Said to Shmuel, you know what? Take the eglas bokar, go to Beis Lechem. I will tell you what you should do when you get there. In other words, right now you have one mission. And he was never told to make a king. He said, I'm going to send you to Yishai Beis Alachmi because I've seen among his sons there will be a king. Why are you going? You're going to bring a carbon. When you get there, I'll tell you what to do. So right now, in all honesty, he has one mission, and that is to bring the carbon, and then he'll await further instructions. So therefore, he doesn't have two missions at this moment. Vayash Shmuel, Shmuel did Esa Shediver Hashem, what Hashem said. Vayavu Beis Lechem, and he came to Beis Lechem. Vayecherdu, there was a trembling. Some say there was a trembling because they saw he came with an egel arufa. Maybe there was a dead person that they didn't hear about. Or maybe Shmuel came to give Musar. All of a sudden, this wasn't a scheduled visit. All of a sudden, Shmuel shows up. Vayecherdu, they trembled. The Zigni or Yerli Krosso, the elders of the city, came to greet Shmuel. Vayomer, and he said, Shalom Boecha, are you coming in peace? And Chazal learned out, obviously, there was a whole group that came to meet him, of the Zakanim, the elders, the most respected, but the greatest one spoke, Vayomer. In other words, one person spoke, he was the spokesman, Vayomer, and he said, Shalom Boecha, are you coming in peace? They learned this as a question. And it's missing a vav in the word shalom, because they detected something's wrong. And they just had that intuition. Shalom, it's not, there isn't peace, something's wrong. They said to him, Shalom Boecha, are you coming in peace? Vayomer Shalom. So Shmuel said, no, with a vav, everything's fine, there's peace, no problems. I'm not coming to give Musar. Lizboach Hashem Bossi. I'm coming to bring a carbon to Hashem. Hiskachu, prepare yourself. Uvosem iti bazovach, and you'll come with me for the carbon. I'd like you to participate in this bringing of the carbon. Vayakadesh es Yishai ves bonav, and he was makadesh. He imbued Yishai and his sons. He prepared them, imbued them with a special kedusha, or he told them how to prepare themselves. This is going to be a spiritually uplifting experience. This is not to focus on the negative. This is not a musar shmooze, but he's going to bring a carbon and become close to Hashem. And he singled out Yishai and his sons, Vayikro lehem lazovach, and he called them to join in the carbon. Vayhi bevoam, and it was when they came, they all came together, Vayares Eliyov, and Shmuel saw Eliyov. Eliyov was the oldest son of Yishai. Vayomer, and Shmuel said, Ach, but neged Hashem Mashicho. Hashem's anointed one is opposite him. Meaning, one way of learning this must be the king. Eliyav had such an appearance, he looked like royalty. It's Hashem was with Shmuel. Hashem was with Shmuel. It's like the anointed one of Hashem, the one who should be king, is right in front of us. Neged Hashem Mashicho, the anointed one is right here. And we'll see another way to learn that in a moment. But Vayomer Hashem el Shmuel, Hashem said to Shmuel, Al Tabed el Mareyu, don't look at his appearance. Vel Gavo Akomoso, and the tallness of his height, his stature. Kimastiyu, I've despised him. Kilo, it's not as you say, it's not Asher Yire Ha'odom, the way a person sees. Ki Ha'odom Yire La'inayim, a person sees by the eyes. Vashem Yirel Alevov, and Hashem sees the heart. Eliyav is not the one, I've despised him. Now the question is exactly why they despise. So Hashem doesn't despise somebody unless he did an aveira, unless he did something wrong. And I was like, what do you mean? And what did Eliyav do wrong? And we haven't discussed him at all yet. Chazal say, and this will only come up later on, in Perek Yud Zayin, we see that Eliyav got angry at David, and he said to David, why do you leave the sheep and you came to the battlefront? It's exciting, you go to war, you see the excitement, you get a little bored out there watching the sheep. And he got angry. Obviously that anger, even though that incident happened later, but he obviously had that mead of anger, and because of his inner defect in character, Hashem despised him. Now again, you'll tell me it's kind of depressing to mention that, but it obviously was something that the eyes of the Navi didn't pick up on. Or Eliyahu's maisim and his actions, I assumed, it's Hashem Yir Lalevav. In his heart, there was this shortcoming. He had this shortcoming, and therefore Hashem despised him. Other Mephorshim say, Why are you looking at Eliyahu? Why are you thinking that Hashem's anointed is right opposite him? Because he looks like a king. So Hashem said to Shmuel, we already had that experience. You know already from Shul, it's Hashem, I don't care about the person who looks like a king. Hashem, you're a Lalevav. In other words, not that I despise Eliyahu. Could be Eliyahu himself didn't do anything wrong at this point. But Kimastiu, I despise that whole outlook. The idea to look at somebody and say, oh, he looks like he can play the role. He looks like royalty. That's not, I despise that whole approach. And a third, and a way of understanding it, the exact opposite. And the Malbim actually prefers this. And the other Mephorshim mentioned, Abar Benel. What Hashem said, or what Shmuel said was, he took a look at Eliyahu. And he said, Eliyahu? The king? No way! Eliyahu looks like he's... He didn't look at all fit to be a king. And Shmuel thought to himself, wow, if that's the competition, Shul will have another chance. Ach neged Hashem Mashicho, your anointed one is right in front of you. What about Shul? Take a look. It should be Eliyahu. It's got to be Shul. So Hashem said, no, I haven't changed what I told you previously about Shul. Al Tabid Omareyu, forget about Shul. Shul is not the one. But of course, it was like a given that Eliyahu couldn't be the one. Well, and Yishai will try his other sons. And as Eliyahu was so obvious, even everyone knew it can't be Eliyahu. But even Shol, no, Kilo Asher Yira HaAdam, a person sees by the eyes, and Hashem sees the heart, and Hashem doesn't want Shol. So either doesn't want Shol, or he doesn't want Eliyahu. And Ki Adam Yira Lainayim could mean either a person sees with his eyes, which is a limited vision, and Hashem is able to penetrate and see the heart. Or it can mean, in general, you see the externalities of a person, his eyes, meaning his body, you see his eyes, and Hashem is the one who sees inward what a person wants. It's a lesson you have to be don people a kav zechus. In other words, as whatever you think of people, in other words, Everyone's playing this world on a different playing field. As everyone has his own challenges and everyone has his own problems and his own difficulties, and you never know exactly what a person is going through. And the only one who knows that is Hashem, knows that we're trying. Vayikra Yishai el Avinodov. Yishai called Avinodov. And he had Avinodav pass in front of Shmuel. Vayomer, and he said, Gambazel Bochar Hashem. Hashem didn't choose this one either. Eliyahu no, Avinodav no. Vayaver Yishai Shama. Yishai had his son Shama go by. Vayomer, and he said, Gambazel Bochar Hashem. Hashem doesn't want this one either. That's three attempts, and three sons were turned down. Vayaver Yishai Shiva Sponov Lifnei Shmuel. She Yishai had all seven sons go in front of Shmuel. Vayomer Shmuel, Yishai. Shmuel said to Yishai, Lo Bochra Hashem Va'ela. Hashem didn't choose these. Now it's interesting, David wasn't even here. Or Shmuel said to Yishai, Yishai should come with his sons, and David wasn't there. Vayomer Shmuel Yishai. So Shmuel said to Yishai, Hasamu Hanarim? Are all the boys finished? That's all you have? He knew there has to be something more, because Hashem said one of the sons is going to be a king, and he was told clearly none of these. Vayomer, so almost like an afterthought. So Yishai says, Vayomer, Od Shar HaKotan. Yeah, as a matter of fact, the youngest one remains. And even though it, you know, in the storybooks that might show little David, you know, with a slingshot or whatever, David was probably around 30 years old at the time. Because we know he was 70 when he was an Iftar and he was king for 40 years. He was around 30. Od Shara Kotna, but the little one remained. Bine Roya Batsain, and he's taking care of the sheep. Vayomer Shmuel, Yishai, Shmuel said to Yishai, Shilcha send v'kachenu and bring him. Kilo noso v'adbofo, we won't sit down to any meal until David is here. Until that son that remained is here. It doesn't usually, the word, in Lashon HaKodesh, you almost always have the form, what's called nifal. It would say, oh, nishar. The word shoar is a very unusual form of the word. It doesn't say, oh, nishar hakotan. The cotton remains. Because nishar is almost as if others left it behind. You gathered together a bunch of stuff, and something was nishar, something remained behind. Here was shoar, what, like, David himself did, like Od Shoar HaKotan, the Kotan remained, meaning David himself remained because could be he felt, why should he come? He's the youngest of the crowd. He knows he's the Kotan. They treated him, we'll see, like the Kotan. He stayed behind, Od Shoar HaKotan, the Kotan remained behind of his own will, and as he knows he's the Kotan. Not only that, but he's busy. He's busy at work, and he figures it doesn't involve him at all, this meeting with Shmuel. So he's out there by the sheep. And Chazal mentioned about the milah of somebody taking care of the sheep. It's not by coincidence that you find Yaakov Avinu took care of the sheep, and Moshe, and David, and there was a Novi Amos that raised sheep. And it seems that there are two advantages to being a shepherd. One advantage is a person's out there alone in the field with the sheep, and he has time to contemplate. Very often when a person's with others, and just the conversation, taking care of all the petty details and the nitty-gritty and the back and forth and the conversation, it gets a person sort of caught up in this world. While a person who's out there in the sheep, there's a Rashi in Yuma on Daf Dalet Amud Beis. And he talks about the Kohen Gadol before Yom Kippur was secluded for 7 days. Over there Rashi says, Shetochel Olov Eimo, a person gets a certain awe, a certain fear for Hashem, B'yosel Levado, when he's by himself. Yovin V'yosin Levovo, he can understand and he puts his heart, Likones L'machna Shechina Be'eimo, to realize that the Kohen Gadol is going to be going into the Holy of Holies. And he just has time to think about the greatness of Hashem and about who he is. And there's nothing really, things are quiet out there in the sheep. You have time to think. The Bali Musar always speak about the importance of a person taking off some time to contemplate, you know, what's important in life and what's not. That's one thing with a shepherd. The second thing with a shepherd is you're taking care of the feeble, the infirm, those sheep that need help, that you develop that compassion. It says in Tehillim, in Perek Ayin Ches, David mentions he was taking mimichlos tzon from the pens, from taking care of the pens of sheep. And the Chazal are now, he would tie up the sheep, he would keep the sheep in a corral, and when they came to a new pasture area, first he let out the little sheep that had didn't have strong teeth yet and needed help, and they would eat the top of the grass that was nice and soft. Then after the young sheep were able to eat, those that were older came and they ate the center part of the stalk that was tougher, and then the older sheep that were really strong and tough, they ate the bottom of the stalks, the roots, that was already, for that you needed adult teeth. But there was a certain, the way a person takes care of the sheep, to pick up the little sheep that needs a help and bring them to the water, greatness. We're not used to thinking that way. But those, if you look through the biographies of the Gedolim and the Tzaddikim, you'll find very often a lot of them were the ones who were taught first and second grade. You know, we're able to take care of those who needed the compassion and the love. And in other words, there's a certain greatness that comes from somebody who can take care of the sheep and try to make them, try to care for them. Somebody who is that type of background is the person that Hashem says he can take care of the Jewish people. because the leader is supposed to be somebody who has patience, like we know from Moshe Rabbeinu. You have to have patience, you have to have tolerance, and you have to be able to put up with all of the problems that are caused by leading a large group of independent-minded people that are themselves, and that they know their mamlechus kayanim v'goy kadosh. People like Klal Yisrael know how great they are, and they expect their leader to be able to deal with them likewise. There is, as he pointed out, there's a symbolism of taking care of the sheep, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Klal Yisrael is like the sheep, right? Ketzon Kadoshim. So, therefore, David was taking care of the sheep, and he didn't come. Vayishlach vayevieyu. So, Yishai sent vayevieyu, and they brought David, hu admoni. And David was reddish. We know Admoni, who was the one who was Admoni, was Esav. He looked like a killer. He had that ruddy complexion to him, that somebody that perceives somebody like an Esav. He didn't look like somebody to sit and learn in yeshiva all day. Im yifei naim, and he had nice eyes, v'tov ro, he had a pleasant appearance. Vayomer Hashem, so Hashem said, Kum Shachayu, get up and anoint him, ki zehu, that's the one. This is the one I want for king. Chazal learned out that when Shmuel saw him, Vahu Admoni, and he was reddish, he thought, a person like that, a person who's able to kill, to live by the sword, somebody Admoni, he can't be the leader of Klal Yisrael. How could he be the one? And Hashem said, Im Yifei Einayim. It's together with Yifei Einayim. First of all, Yifei Einayim in general, a Lichtige Eugen or whatever, the eyes can, sometimes you can see the person is an intellectual, he's a bright person, V'tov Roi, has a pleasant appearance, he doesn't look like a rough, and he doesn't look like a coarse individual, he has that Admoni appearance, but he otherwise looks like he's an intelligent, he's Yifei Naim V'Tov Roi. But on a deeper level, the Sanhedrin is called the eyes of the people. The leaders are the eyes of Klal Yisrael. They see the future, they see what should be done. David had that nature of an Admoni, but it was Im Yifei Einayim, together with Yifei Einayim V'Tov Roi, means he saw things with the eyes of Sanhedrin. Meaning whatever he did was done al pi Hashem, was done with a clear das Torah. So he was Admoni, but it was all being done al pi Hashem. And therefore he's the one to be the one who is the leader of Klal Yisrael. And there are mafarshim that learn that David intrinsically was not born with the good nature, with the good person that you would imagine would be the manig of Klal Yisrael, the great David HaMelech. But what David did was he channeled and he broke his Yetzahara and he worked on himself to take his midos the way they were and do and totally serve Hashem with them. And that ability is what made David the king. The Gemara says in Shabbos and Daf Kuf Nun Vav, if somebody's born under certain constellations, a person's given certain natural characteristics. And the Gemara discusses if somebody's born, it discusses under Mars, under Madim, is the red stars, whatever that means, what all this, astrological actually meanings are, is we don't understand. But somebody born as a killer, as somebody who would shed blood, if that's his nature, that's what he will be. But his bechira is what to do with it. If the guy's a Rasha, he'll be a Rotzeach, he'll be a murderer. If a person is a Beinoni, an average person, he'll be a Sheikhet. Go, let him go ahead. Or if the person is the person who can spill blood, let him be a Sheikhet. And everybody will have kosher meat. Let him be a doctor. And the highest madrega is a person who should be a Mayel. In other words, if that's his nature, you can't break a person's nature. They speak on Chanuch Lenar al Pidarko. Everybody has his nature. So not everyone, you know, it's difficult because now there's compulsory education and everybody's cut out to be the scholar. But the truth is, different people have natures, and at a certain point in life, a person has to realize what his nature is, and whatever he does, he has to do it to serve Hashem. David had the nature of an Admoni. But we'll see what he did is he fought the Molchamos Hashem, the battles of Hashem, and he will not be the one to build the Beis HaMikdash. The Beis HaMikdash is not built by somebody who spills blood, because the Beis HaMikdash has to be a place of shalom. But David HaMelech reached the greatest, greatest Madregas. He was Admoni, but it was together with Yefei Enayim. Ba'ikach Shmuel Eskeren Hashem. Shmuel took the horn of oil. Oh, by the way, there's an asterisk if you see in the middle of that pasuk. That's like a psik, like a break. In the Tanakh, it's written, there's a big space over there. In the Novi. He took and he brought David and Yefei Enayim v'Tov Ro'i. There's a big space in the Novi. Because this is like, we're now starting a new chapter. We are now beginning Malchus Beis David. Vayomer Hashem kum mishachehu ki zehu, anoint him because he's the one. And Chazal learned out, by the way, ki zehu, only a melech from Malchus Beis David can be anointed with Shemen HaMishcha, with this special oil. Any other king, let's say Malchus Yisrael, we see the kingdom over the 10 tribes, whenever somebody was anointed, it wasn't the real oil. It was Shemen HaFarsimon, perfumed oil. It was not the Shemen HaMishcha. Because a regular person on whom the Shemen HaMishcha, who smears the Shemen HaMishcha, is Chayiv Koras. This is singled out specifically for the Kohen Gadol, for Malchus Beis David. Kizehu, this one, as opposed to other kings. It has to be a king from Malchus Beis David. Vayikach Shmuel Eskeren HaShemen. Shmuel took the horn of oil. Vayimshach Oso Bekerev Echov. And he anointed David bekerev echov. And that's a phrase like the Torah says, mikerev achecha tosim olecha melech. The king has to come from amongst Klal Yisrael. And we're stressing that David was anointed bekerev echov, meaning whatever questions there were on his yichus are misplaced, and he's part of Klal Yisrael, he's mikerev echov, and he's the perfect king. And whatever concerns that he came from Moav are groundless, because it's mutter, without a question. Vatitzach ruach Hashem al David. And the spirit of Hashem also passed over David. Me'ayom ahu v'mola. From that day on, he had a special ruach Hashem. Vayokam Shmuel got up, vayelech haramosa, and he went back to Ramah. And we'll see, which is startling, because when Shaul was anointed king, Shmuel met with Shaul many times, and they talked. They talked that night, and they talked in the morning. Here, David's brought from the sheep. Let's try to picture it. And Shmuel anoints him with the oil, and then Shmuel gets up and he goes on his way. He didn't say a word to David exactly how he's supposed to conduct his malchus. Especially over here, it's very unique because Shaul was still the king. He's anointed as the king, but there is a king. Obviously, Shmuel relied on the fact that David would know what to do. There was Vatitzlach Ruach Hashem al David. There was a Ruach that passed immediately on David. By Shaul, he didn't immediately get that spirit. We learned before over there, Shmuel kissed him, and he gave him chizik, and he gave him a number of signs that when the signs come true, you'll know that indeed you are the one. But here, as soon as he anointed David, there was a special Ruach Hashem that went on to David from that point on. So Shmuel didn't say anything to him. Now we'll see later on, there was one time when David was running away from Shaul, David went to Shmuel. But it's interesting because, as I say, it wasn't like Shmuel spent a lot of time preparing David for the Malchus. He was the one chosen, and Shmuel went back to Ramah. The spirit of Hashem, the Targum mentions, there was a Ruach Nevuah that went min kodom Hashem al David. And as David got a spirit of Nevuah, as the Tehillim and all of the the praises of David HaMelech. David had a level of Ruach HaKadosh, that's this Ruach Hashem. The Ruach Hashem also, Rashi mentions, is a Ruach Gevura, a Ruach of courage, that he's going to lead the people as the dynamic leader, and he has that bravery, he has a Ruach Gevura. So the Ruach involves different types of benefits, a special Ruach Hashem that would enable David to fulfill his calling. In Tehillim, in general, from now till we're finished with David, you sort of have to keep one eye on a Sefer Tehillim and notice the Tehillim that's connected with what happened here. In Tehillim it says what David's reaction was. In Tehillim Chof Aleph. And there's a mizmor that David talks about. He says, Hashem ba'ozcha yismach melech, the king will have a simcha with your strength. Tavas libo nasatelo, what he desired, you're given to him. And he mentions about the bitochen of the king, ki ha-melech poteach b'Hashem, the king's trust has to be in Hashem. So you see, when he was anointed, his reaction to it. Chazal also mentioned that when he was anointed, David HaMelech said, Orcha Hashem ki ani soni, I'll praise you. And then Yishai said, Evin mosu abonim hoysel rosh pina, that who can imagine the stone that was despised by the builders? And the brothers said, Me'es Hashem hoysazos. They realized that this was from Hashem that David was chosen as the king. And Shmuel said, Zehayom asa Hashem, this is the day that Hashem made, because he foresaw that David would save Klal Yisrael from the enemies and would help bring Klal Yisrael up to the highest madrigas. The Ruach Hashem Saramim Shol. The Spirit went on to David, and the Ruach Hashem left Shol. Uviasatu Ruach Rome'es Hashem. And now he was scared with a bad spirit from Hashem. Question is exactly what the connection is. Some learn it could be like Hashem gave him this spirit of depression. Others learn that the very fact that David was now anointed and the Ruach Gevura went to David, at the same time Shaul was contemplating the fact that he lost the Malchus. In other words, while all this was transpiring, this was right after the incident with Amalek. And as Shaul thought about the way he lost the Malchus, he fell into a depression. And others learned that it's actually directly connected, that there's a special Ruach that goes to the king. And only one person can have it, the person who's the king that Hashem wants. Once the Ruach Hashem went to David, perforce it had to leave Shaul in order for that to happen. So Shaul now felt a vacuum. He felt that he no longer has a Siyata Dishmaya. And he fell into a deep melancholy. It's interesting because you're thinking melancholy is a modern day word. But I saw the word is brought down, by the way, in our Barbanel, meaning the word is at least from the 1400s. He writes, he writes the exact melancholy in Hebrew. It's obviously an ancient word. But that's the word they use for it. Vayomer Abdi Shaul Elov. So the Avodim of Shaul said to him, Hineino Ruach Elokim Ra, a spirit of Hashem that's bad, is Mevai Techa, is now frightening you. The Pasuk before said it was a Ruach Hashem, which could be, it came with the Midas HaRachamim. It's hard to understand exactly what the Rachamim and what the compassion is. But those who had to deal with, those who had to deal with it, the way they saw it, it was certainly Ruach Elokim. This is a Midas HaDin, a judgment, that some terrible punishment that Shaul now has to deal with a crisis in life. And they said to him, Yomar no Adonenu, let our master now say, and you just say it, Avadech lefanechu, your servants are in front of you, we're all at your beck and call. Just say this request that you agree and we'll immediately do it. But it would appear to us, Yivakshu, let them seek out. We're not going to get somebody who's standing around here. We need somebody who's very special. We're going to seek him out. An isha person, yodea menagin bakinor. Not just a musician. Not just an ish who's menagin. He has to be yodea. somebody who knows and has a deep appreciation of music. And his menagin bekiner, he himself is an accomplished musician. When the Ruach Elohim, the bad spirit from Hashem, will be on show, he'll play the music with his hands, it'll be good for you. Now, there are different reasons why a person can have depression. If it's caused, and I say that the way I understand it, the Mephorshim actually deal with it, it's again, it's funny because you couch it in modern terms. You think this is like a recent, you know, discussing chemical imbalances. But they discuss the Marash Shchora. And sometimes a person is depressed because physically something, there's a chemical imbalance. There's the hormones and different things are causing his mood. Now, if that's the reason, playing music, it doesn't help. But sometimes a person's depression is that a person's his thoughts on life, it's in the mind, the way he perceives things. They're not good, they're not cheerful, things are dreary, there's no hope for the future, things are sad. It's in the mind. Sometimes if a person like that, if you play music, you can have, he'll be able to lift him out of the depression. That people who get depressed in the winter, they say, and it's a dreary day, they'll say, for that they have to be in the sunlight a few hours. But certain people, if it's caused, you have to know what's causing the depression. They suggest that if you have somebody who's a musician and he knows music and he's able to play music to deal with your mood and lift it up, it can bring Shaul out of that depression. Vayomer Shaul al Avodim, Shaul said to his Avodim, Ru'u na li, see now for me. Or you have to have somebody being aware of the fact who I am. An ish meitiv lenagein. You have a right suggestion, but I'd like to embellish that. Get somebody who's meitiv, who's very good lenagein to play music. Ba'avio sem Elohim, bring him to me. Vayan echad meha na'orim. One of the na'orim now responded. Vayomer, and he said, Hine ro'isi bein le'yishai beis halachmi. Behold, I've seen a son for Yishai from beis lechem. Yodea Nagain, he knows how to play music. V'gibor Chayil, and he's also courageous. He's a man of action. He's a doer. V'ish Melchoma, he's a man who's capable of fighting battles. Unavon Dovar, and he's got an understanding of things, a deep understanding. Tavuna, as you tell him something and he can already build on that. He's a Navon Dovar. The Ishtarn is a man of a striking appearance. Vashem Imon, Hashem is with him. He's the person. Sounds nice, doesn't it? You should know this person, this was one of the worst Lashon Haras that has ever said. The one who said this, Chazal said, Echad Me'an Arim, one of the Arim. It's one, meaning he's a unique, he's a special person, he's an Echad, one of a kind. One of the Na'arim spoke up. It's this person, Doeg Ho'adomi. Now, Doeg Ho'adomi, and we're going to come across him again later, he, on one hand, was one of the greatest Chachamim of the generation. He was leader of the Sanhedrin. On the other hand, I don't know if you should speak in his defense or not, but it must be the fact that he was such a Gadol B'Torah, he felt that could be David's yichus came from Moav. Moav is not even allowed to marry into Klal Yisrael. They're totally shunned. If this David becomes a king, Klal Yisrael's in trouble. So he set out to see to it that Shaul will be jealous of David and Shaul will be against David because we have to stop David because he's a threat to Klal Yisrael. That's perhaps, I don't know if you're supposed to look for a limud zechus, but that I saw in some farm they bring down, that could be that's what Doeg was thinking. But it was obviously so misplaced, and he should have realized it was such a flaw. Doeg is considered to be the biggest Baal Lashon Hara. The Gemara says in the beginning of Chelek, he's one of the four people that singles out four hedyotos, four commoners who don't have a Chelek in Olam Haba. And one of them is Doeg. Or he's written off the books. Because what he did now And you see, it's an example of giving a compliment that's the biggest Lashon Hara. Shoal was looking for somebody to play music. So he should say, I saw somebody who's Yodei, a Nagein, who knows how to play music. To build up David, that he's the greatest of the great, is just going ahead and causing a hatred that Shoal is going to hate David. There is a lot more to say on this perek. Emir Tzashem, we will resume after the summer. Everyone should have a healthy and an invigorating summer, and we'll continue with tape 21 after your vacation.